Does plastic, microplastics, makes us sick? And really, does it affect our health? And this issue is has sparked a lot of discussion in the society and even among scientists. So let's see what the evidence is telling us and what is new in this field. One thing I know for sure is that the microplastic pollution will continue to grow. And we are, so will be our exposure. Basically, plastic doesn't decompose, but it steadily, gradually breaks down in smaller and smaller pieces. So the existing amount of plastic debris already in the environment will produce microplastics over time, constantly, let's say, raising the particle levels. And this is only, you know, the scenario we have to live with, but think about all the plastics waste still to come. So, yeah, some scientists say we're sitting on a plastic time bomb, and I think they're very right about that. It is a plastic time bomb. Now, what are these microplastics? Solid plastic particles, by definition, smaller than 5 millimeters. Also often called nanoplastics, they're smaller than 1 micrometer, thousandths of a millimeter. And they're highly complex. It's not only this one single compound, it's a catch-all term. It's a class of a diverse and highly complex contaminants. They're variable in size, shapes, and composition. They're composed of numerous additives, co-contaminants, and the surface is covered with chemical and biological contaminants. And also the composition of the surface, we call it the corona, the bio or eco-corona, is changing. It changes according to the surrounding environment and the age of the particle. And also from inside, outside to inside the body and across tissue barriers, it changes. So it's the point I want to make here, it's a highly complex contaminant, microplastics. I have a couple of examples here to show you. This is what I found when I vacuum cleaned my house and my workshop. And you can see here, these are visible particles, lots of microplastics. Basically, I can trace some of them back, inadvertently. You know, you can see some fibers there from my clothes. There are some flecks from polymeric paints from my wall there. And these white spheres you can see there, these are called primary plastics, microplastics. They're used in all sorts of products. We know them from cosmetics, for example, but they're in many other goods as well, in this case from cement powder. And there's lots of fragments there, probably from coming sawing, you know, in my workshop, some plastics. So if you go a bit smaller than that, let's say 2 magnitude, or 2 orders of magnitude smaller, and you use a light microscope, you can have a picture like this. This is in water. You can have a similar picture, you see some fibers there, but if you go smaller than that, and this is an extract of soft tissue of a North Sea mussel, it's getting already a bit more foggy there. You can see the smallest particles you recognize here are about the size of a bacterium. Now, the point I want to make here, If you go smaller than 1 micrometer, we're not able yet to measure these very small particles. There's no method yet to analyze or visualize nanoplastics in environmental samples. We can do it in a lab, but not in environmental samples and not in biota. So some progress has been made in this area. Heather Leslie will talk about that later this morning. It is the basic issue here. Now, understanding the risks, the health risks of microplastics, essentially comes down to solving this equation. Risk is hazard times or multiplied by exposure. This equation is often used by toxicologists. And basically, hazard is the potential to cause a harmful effect, to cause harm. And the risk is the probability that the harm occurs. And the exposure makes all the difference in this equation. The exposure makes all the difference. Other components of risk assessment in this case are also, of course, the establishment of dose response relationships, and also to look for, you know, the vulnerable groups. You know, some groups, some people are more vulnerable than other groups, more vulnerable to hazard exposure. Now, let's go first to the one side of the equation, look at the hazards now, what we know about the hazards. And Joe already showed, you know, there are generally three types of hazards that can be associated with exposure to microplastics, and the physical, the chemical, and the microbiological hazards. And the biggest concern is with the physical hazards. And we know that from particularly air pollution, fine dust. We know that, and later this morning, Raymond Peters will tell you a bit more about that. I don't want to take everything away from him now. So, but basically what happens if small particles, particularly the nano-sized particles, are in contact with your mucous membranes, or even, let's say, be absorbed by your body, they will induce and or enhance an immune response that can produce reactive oxidant stress and inflammation, chronic inflammation. And the chronic inflammation can be the onset of a range of other chronic diseases. So, what about the microplastics? Well, there's only a little bit of direct evidence that microplastics may cause similar effects. And that is the Ipalong study that report that textile workers that are exposed to very high concentration of plastic dust, they develop, in some cases, respiratory diseases or and even cancer. But that's the only evidence we have so far, the direct evidence. However, there is a quite increasing body of indirect evidence. We know from, for example, from an increasing number of studies, sorry for this, an increasing number of studies with laboratory animals that inhaled or ingested small plastic particles are capable of crossing the external membranes in lung and intestine. A fraction of it, not all of it, and they can actually enter the circulation. They can cause systemic exposure and can be accumulated in certain organs, tissues, and cause health impairments. And basically, most of the observed effects here are immune and inflammatory reactions. Other studies also suggest and indicate that could be microplastics, nanoplastics can cause DNA damage or developmental disorders, diseases, as well as metabolic and neurotoxic endpoints are also in the picture. So, this growing body of evidence is particularly, in the last couple of years. And if you followed, you know, that 2 years ago we talked about these pioneer studies, these breakthrough projects, the ZonMW, and some of these results were presented late this morning. And there we can actually see that if you use cell models outside the human body, that these particles can, particularly the smaller particles, can cross intestinal walls and the lung, and even the placenta and the blood-brain barrier. And so they can impair functions of placenta cells, for example, in brain cells. And how to do this, I will talk about that later this morning in more detail. So let's go to the exposure side now. What do we know there? Well, there is, of course, you read it all everywhere in the newspapers as well. Microplastics are everywhere. You can find it in food, in drinking water, in the air, etc. But the good quality data is quite limited. There's no standard methodology yet to analyze or to measure microplastics or nanoplastics. So the data we have available is particularly the larger microplastic fractions that are measured. And the couple of trends you can deduct from that, you know, first of all, there is more plastics indoors than outdoors. Microplastics, particularly in house dust, that's one thing. And the other thing is, the major intake pathways are obviously inhalation, but also ingestion, but maybe also dermal skin, eh? And mucous membranes should be considered as well. And this recent paper estimating about the total burden of microplastics we're exposed to, based on the available knowledge from now, and they estimate about 100 million microplastics per day we are exposed to, including the deposition of these particles on your skin, etc., etc. That seems like a very high number. But again, you have to put that in light. You have to consider that, you know, in respect to the total personal ambient particle burden. We live in an all-particle world. And so there are many other particles as well, non-plastic particles. And these burdens may be even 100 or 1,000 times higher. So there we go. Now we go to the body itself. And of course, we heard it already, or not, maybe not, you know, but microplastics have been detected in human stool, for example. And but if microplastics are in our blood is, for me, still a question mark. I think it's very likely it's there. But there are a couple of studies now that find larger microplastics in, for example, placenta tissue or colon tissue, but there is some discussion around these studies because of possible contamination issues. So in reality, we do not know, although it's very likely that's there, like Joe is suggesting. Anyhow, we hear about that later from Heather Leslie, I suppose. So far, we have only very limited exposure data. And that leads you to, you know, the burning questions. How much plastic do we have in our body? Where is it? Where does it go? What does it do? Are the doses in blood and tissue sufficient high to trigger or mediate responses that lead to diseases? That is the basic question here. And another question is, you know, what is the interactions of microplastics on the cellular and tissue levels, the mechanisms behind that? Particularly this corona, the surface of these particles, they change, but they play a role also in the fate and toxicity of these particles. So it's quite complex. And then finally, I think we should also try to find out about how they differ, these particles. How differ microplastics from non-plastic particles we are exposed to? And what is the total burden and the contribution of plastics to the total burden of ambient particle? So the urgency, in my opinion, has never been greater to try to find answers to these questions. And fortunately, a couple of larger European projects have started now. You can see also some movements in Australia. The Mineral Foundation started to look at it, other countries as well. And of course, in the Netherlands, we have the ZonMW and its partners, you know, starting this consortium Momentum that is based on the results of the breakthrough projects. And very exciting stuff. You can find it. You can find it on just Google microplastic momentum, and you find it. Okay, so yeah, a lot going on there. Which is the good news? Now, the conclusions here are very easy, you know? So there's insufficient data to know whether microplastic poses a serious health risk. But there's really a growing body of evidence here that microplastics could be harmful to our health. More research is particularly needed on the internal exposure, but much more research needed. And to be frank, you know, to do a proper risk assessment, Michael, is still years away, far away. Personally, I think about maybe 10 years. So what are we going to do in the meantime? Saying we don't know, you know, maybe, you know, no. Obviously, you know, a precautionary approach is warranted here. But I think it's important to also to realize and to emphasize that microplastics are part of a bigger story, a much bigger story. And of course, there's a wealth of evidence that that plastic debris in general is causing health effects in the general population. Think about the overburning of plastics in the open air, the burning of plastic in the open air, releasing all these toxic. Think about the endocrine disrupting chemicals leaching from plastics. They can be related to local or regional, even maybe global disease burdens and mortalities. So there is a lot to go there. And in fact, if you look at it, the overall presence, the overall pressure of chemicals and particles on the environment and humans is increasing. And if you think about it, plastic have really a large share in this, really a large share. So in this regard, I fully agree with Maria, I support Maria in her statement, you know, that we're facing a public health emergency and really that we need to take forward this one health approach to the impacts of plastic pollution to protect human health. And this one health approach, basically, I will explain to you how that works. Basically, we share our health with that of animals and the environment. We share that, so to protect our health, we need to protect the health of the animals. We have to protect the health of the environment. Basically, that's the story behind it. And of course, that is another point, you know, there are many indirect effects also in this picture. And that can in turn have an effect on human health as well. Personally, I think these are probably more important than the direct effects, and they deserve much more research. Now, finally, I think there's no time to lose. We need to act now. We need a system change, and we will not accept any longer that the profits of certain companies are more important than sustainable and safe future for our children. In particularly early life and children are likely more at risk of plastic pollution. I want to conclude that, and this is a bit of a more personal observation, that we are losing our connection with nature. We should reconnect with nature. We should value nature again. We should value the benefits nature provides through healthy ecosystems. And look at my kid, for example, you know, fertile world and his tablet is taking over, you know, for a nice day out in nature. I think we have to educate and engage our children to take care of it. Children are our future and the planet's future. And I believe that this is essential in helping to save this planet, to save our health and also to save the health of future generations. Thank you very much for your attention.